We felt that Neil had the very best start, and as a result, Neil hasn't been sick once, and he's 1 year and 2 months old now, and he hasn't had colic. He started sleeping through the night at 5 weeks, and he's been like that ever since. And I think it's all because of the mother and baby program that it makes having a baby so smooth and makes me able to think about having another one.
When I had Cecil and started going through this program, I started feeling better than I'd ever felt before. And after a period of about 3 weeks, I felt like I'd never even had a baby, you know, or it was just so wonderful. And by the end of the 6 week period, I was 10 pounds less than when I got pregnant. And I felt better than I had in so long. It was just a remarkable experience for me.
I think the mother-baby program was just the right thing for me after being in labor for hours, and it has helped me recover very fast, and it has made me very strong, and the rest that it has given me is deep, you know, and it has made me so happy, and a happy mother creates and produces happy babies.
My pleasure to welcome you to Bissful Baby, Ayurveda Mother and Baby Program. A comprehensive approach which has been enjoyed by families throughout the United States and around the world. Today is Dr. Nancy Lonsdorf. Lonsdorf received her medical degree from the School of Medicine and went on to postgraduate study in psychiatry at Stanford University School of Medicine. Currently medical director of the Maharishi Ayurveda Medical Center in Washington, D.C. Joining us also, Margaret Mullins. She started the baby program with the Maharishi Ayurveda in Washington, D.C., too. She has 6 years of experience as an obstetric nurse and educator. Also, Sarah Berno, who has spent the past 3 years pioneering the Maharishi Ayurveda program. Mrs. Berno is director of Mother Baby Maharishi Ayurveda Medical Center for the Midwest, located in Fairfield, Iowa. We'll be learning important new knowledge to maximize health and happiness for yourself and your baby. Welcome. Let's start right from the beginning, Dr. Lonsdorf, in a few terms. What do we mean by Maharishi Ayurveda?
And Maharishi Ayurveda is an ancient and comprehensive system. It's formally recognized by the World Health Organization. It means science or and it contains programs in all areas of life to improve mind, body, and behavior. Its focus is on prevention and on promoting optimal health and well. Now, Ayurveda has a deep understanding of the relationship between the individual and her environment and nature. And this extends to the environment in the family. Relationships between, for example, parents and children. And what we'll be talking about Ayurveda has to offer in terms of optimizing the relationship and promoting the health.
Now, I noticed you used the term Maharishi Ayurveda as opposed to Ayurveda. Why did you make that distinction?
Ayurveda is this ancient system which has been around for well over 500 years. In fact, even before it was carried on as an oral tradition over those many centuries and millennia, much of the original knowledge of Ayurveda was lost. Been within the past decade that Maharishi Mahesh Yogi, who is the founder of the program, has begun to revive this knowledge in its completeness and its fullness, bringing back the value of and stress reduction to this knowledge, and all of the different avenues, all the programs in Ayurveda. They include things from music and aromatherapy to daily routine to diet to the herbs that are used.
Clara, you've had lots of experience in introducing Maharishi Ayurveda to mothers and fathers. What sorts of benefits have you observed? Why is this program?
Well, I feel very, very fortunate instructor in the program for 2.5 years, and I think that impresses me most is to see a new mother so quickly from the strain and fatigue of pregnancy and delivery, to see that there are some simple steps for herself that will help her to restore and maintain her health, and this has a direct influence on her baby and the being of her baby. And of course this has an impact on the father as well. He sees his wife and his baby becoming happier, becoming stronger and more balanced every day, and he feels happier, he feels less worry. And I think this is Dr. Lonsdorf had mentioned a cycle of nourishment, a cycle of love and nourishment, and I think this is what it is, the mother and the father and the baby. They interact and they nourish each other, and this type of interchange makes the whole raising the child makes it very easy and very fulfilling.
Dr. Lonsdorf, you mentioned this comprehensive natural medical system. What kind of therapies could we expect to see in Maharishi Ayurveda?
Well, there are at least 20 approaches that Maharishi Ayurveda has to promote. And these 20 approaches can be grouped together under the categories of mind, then body, behavior, and the environment. Under each of these, there are specific techniques and procedures that Ayurveda offers. For example, under the area of stress management, through the direction of the mind, we have the transcendental meditation technique, which has been very widely scientifically researched and shown to have a very profound benefit on all areas of health. The physiology, we have diet according to body type or institutional type. We have exercise programs designed for the individual according to body type. We have many herbal supplements that are utilized in addition to the diet to create more balance. And then from the level of behavior, we have a very profound understanding of the biological rhythms within the individual and how to attune those to the rhythms in nature to promote health. And then, of course, from the level of the environment, many ways to improve the environment and our relationships. So Ayurveda provides a complete structure for improved health within the family.
Now, you mentioned prescribed according to constitutional type. Could you explain what that means for individualized?
Right. Well, one of the important principles in Ayurveda is the recognition that individuals vary. And of course, we know that in modern medicine, when we approach patients, that everyone is different. But Ayurveda has a way of categorizing and classifying individuals according to certain psychophysiological characteristics. And that gives us, as the doctor, a way to individualize that person's diet, their exercise, their daily routine, to optimize health for them, to prevent the types of diseases that they may be prone to due to their body type.
You said earlier that Maharishi Ayurveda represents a very extensive body of knowledge from thousands of years ago, ancient tradition, and yet it's only been available to us very recently. Could you tell us a little bit more about this revival?
Well, and Maharishi Mahesh Yogi, who founded the Transcendental Meditation Program, brought it to the world at large about 30 years ago. And in that time, over 3 million people have learned the TM technique, including over 6,000 medical doctors like myself who practice the TM technique and also recommend it to their patients. TM is the most widely documented scientifically technique for self-development and promoting health. In fact, a recent study showed that there was a reduction by 50% of healthcare use by people practicing TM, meaning that only half as many times did they need to go to the doctor or the hospital. And in fact, that reduction was even greater in older individuals. So it indicates that TM very much promotes health and also helps to reduce the effect of aging on the body. So we consider TM to be the consciousness or stress management aspect of Maharshi Ayurveda. Now, the other aspects of Ayurveda have only been brought out in about the last 10 years by Maharshi. And he has been meeting with the leading experts in Ayurveda in India and the Ayurvedic scholars to develop all of these hidden, lost parts of Ayurveda so they can restore it to its completeness and to its full effectiveness.
How has the general public responded to this knowledge?
They're very eager for it. I think people in the public and also physicians are well aware of the gaps that exist in modern medicine. Modern medicine is very effective at treating very severe and acute problems, but when it comes to prevention, when it comes to promoting health and extending life with good health, modern medicine has some gaps in it, which Ayurveda fills. Also, physicians find that Ayurveda is not in conflict with their modern medical training. It's really just complementary.
To give us a deeper understanding of how Maharishi Ayurveda views the care of new mothers and babies, I interviewed one of the main authorities of Maharishi Ayurveda, Dr. Deepak Chopra. Dr. Chopra is a physician and endocrinologist who completed his specialty training in hospitals associated with Harvard and Tufts Medical School and is former chief of staff of New England Memorial Hospital. Dr. Chopra is the author of four popular books on Maharishi Ayurveda and is a leading authority in this area.
Dr. Chopra, in your books, you describe the mind-body connection. Could you give us an idea of what you mean by this and how Maharishi Ayurveda describes this?
Well, in the past, it used to be thought that the mind is here and the body is elsewhere. Now we are recognizing that we have a body-mind and it's one unit. That for every thought, emotion, feeling, desire that you have, there is a corresponding physiological reaction. It is strictly in a chemical that's formed with every feeling or emotion that you generate. You form a real physiological response. You get a real physiological response. And Maharishi Ayurveda says that both the mind and body are different aspects of a fundamental force that's underlying both of them, and that's called consciousness. And Maharishi Ayurveda takes us much beyond our present understanding of the mind-body connection. Maharishi Ayurveda says that our bodies are much like the printout in a computer. The hardware is in the nervous system. The software is all these biochemicals that run the program of the nervous system. And then there's a program behind that. That's what gives us the information. And behind the program is a programmer, and that programmer is consciousness, is the force of consciousness.
Now, how can this principle be applied to the mother-baby program?
Well, in Maharishi Ayurveda, we would consider the mother and baby as one organism, part of the cosmic organism, which is the universe. And the intimate relationship that's there between the mother and the baby is felt to be extremely important, and it felt to start right at the moment of conception. And according to the principles of Maharishi Ayurveda, if the mother has a pregnancy that is full of happiness and bliss and comfort, then those impulses of intelligence will be permeated through the physiology of the child as well. And it will actually result in a better development and a more integrated development of the actual physical structure of the child, because the physical structure is coming out of consciousness. And the mother's consciousness permeates the baby's consciousness.
What is your vision for family health care in the future?
My vision for family health care in the future is that people will be brought up in an environment which is supportive, which fosters love, which fosters compassion, which ultimately gives us the vision of Maharishi Ayurveda, that the world is my family, that every child tomorrow will come with that vision that the world is my family.
It seems that Maharishi Ayurveda is a very comprehensive system. What does it have to do specifically for mothers and babies?
Well, the primary theme of Maharishi Ayurveda is to establish balance in the physiology. And this theme is presented in the sense not only of treatment of disease, but also in terms of prevention of illness in the first place. And this is accomplished through a multifaceted approach. Partially, Dr. Lonsdorf has been talking about this. This is carried over in the mother-baby program in terms of diet recommendations, recommendations for daily routine, the massage itself, and there are other recommendations made also.
How does this differ from contemporary obstetrical practices?
Well, I was very excited when I first participated in the Maharishi Ayurveda mother-baby program, partly because I'm a mother, but also as a nurse, my primary background had been in obstetric care. And the whole focus in terms of contemporary obstetric practice is to put tremendous emphasis and attention on a mother's actual pregnancy, what type of labor is she going to have, what type of delivery will it be. There's all this attention on this period of pregnancy and labor and delivery, and then once she's delivered, there's just basically figured you're on your own. As long as no health care problems develop, you know, you're discharged home and everything's considered to be fine. And Ayurveda has a whole different knowledge to give to mothers and to benefit not only the mother but the whole family, so that when she goes home, when she's had the delivery, that then there's this knowledge to reestablish balance in her physiology and really help in her rejuvenation. And the benefits carry over not just for the mother, but for the baby, in terms of the baby massage, and for the whole family. So it's just very, very beautiful. And personally, I feel it really fills a gap that exists in contemporary medical practice in terms of the field of obstetrics.
Heard this term bonding, which describes that intimate relationship between parent and newborn, Dr. Lonsdorf. Is there any basis to that?
Well, actually, Anne, there is. There's a prominent theory in bonding research that the bond that develops between mother and baby represents a type of entrainment or attunement of the baby's biological rhythms with the mother. There's a scientific principle called entrainment, which refers to the fact that natural cycles, for example, pendulums swinging in the same room, that those natural cycles tend to synchronize over time, so that eventually all the pendulums start swinging back and forth together in synchrony. And the same thing between mother and baby, there's an attunement that occurs in their biological rhythms. One example is that the baby's breathing is found to start synchronizing with the mother's when the baby's being help closely to the mother. So we feel that through the Maharishi Ayurveda program, by reducing stress, by improving that settled state of awareness, that more settled physiology, that the mother and baby are better able to tune themselves to each other. And that's why we feel that this bonding, this very important strengthening of that connection between mother and baby that occurs during early childhood, that Maharishi Ayurveda helps to strengthen that.
In addition, the Maharishi Ayurveda mother and baby program really focuses on a very crucial period for a woman, which is the postpartum fatigue. For when a woman is pregnant and delivers, her physiology goes through more challenges than she's ever had to face before. And on the level of her heart, it's very enlivening. She feels very deep love and gratitude and appreciation for her new baby. But on the level of the body, there is, again, a very difficult challenge. And this is the role of the mother-baby program, to help her overcome that and become more balanced and stronger.
We've heard a lot about the application of Maharishi Ayurveda for newborns. What about the value of Maharishi Ayurveda with older children?
Maharishi Ayurveda has valuable programs for children of all ages. Ayurveda, there's a saying that goes, well begun is half done. And being prevention-oriented, we start very early with these Ayurvedic programs. But I've seen much value for children, even of ages into teenage years, with the Ayurvedic programs.
We've heard a lot about the theory of Maharishi Ayurveda, and now we'll have a demonstration of one of the most important therapies you can use at home to help maximize the health and happiness of your newborn. But first, we heard we have a demonstration with our blissful family here. I'd like to give a little background on this massage program from Dr. Lonsdorf. Dr. Lonsdorf, tell us a little bit about why and how this is so important, such an important part of Maharishi Ayurveda.
Maharishi Ayurveda has always emphasized the value of this oil massage called Abhyanga for both babies and their mothers. The massage for the baby includes specific techniques which help to relieve muscular tension and soothe the baby, create a settled, happy disposition. The ancient Ayurvedic texts even say that it helps to promote function of the immune system and to improve circulation. And many of our mothers report that it also helps to reduce the problems that the child has with colic and other such problems.
Very good. So let's start with a demonstration. Clara, would you like to do the introductions for us?
It's a very great pleasure to introduce Julia and Art Marchand and their beautiful little daughter Simone, who's 3 months old. And ideally for the routine, you do the Abhyanga and then bathing and then some nice little exercises. And then Simone will really be set for a very relaxed and happy day. It's good to select the It's good to select the bathroom as a place to do the Abhyanga because it is self-contained and you can control the heat in the bathroom. We don't want it too cool because that would make it uncomfortable for Simone. She might fuss a little bit and you might think she's not comfortable with the Abhyanga, but really she'd just be feeling some draft and be a little cool. So you want to get set up first and be leaning against the bathtub or a wall with a pillow behind your back, a pillow underneath your knees so you're very comfortable, and be sitting on a sheet or towel, and have two or three towels handy so you can be ready for anything that might come up.
Julia, are you comfortable in that position? Does your baby feel safe to you?
Yes, I like this position because she's nice and secure between my knees and she's not going to slip, and I like her facing me so I can see how she's feeling.
I think she likes that too. She's very blissful. Clark, most of the equipment will be outlined in our educational packet, so maybe you could give us an overview of what's required for this.
Well, as I mentioned, you're going to have about three towels and a couple of pillows, and have your bathtub, the baby bathtub, handy if you want, or use the big tub with a little spongy in it. That's very comfortable. And you'll go ahead and run the bathtub first with nice warm water so that it'll cool off just a bit as you're doing the Abhyanga. You're going to want a nice plastic container with a flip top for your sesame oil. And it's good to have a container with warm water so you can put the contain this plastic in another container of hot water so it'll be nice and warm and comfortable for your baby.
About how much oil would you use for a massage?
Well, you really just use a tiny bit. For Simone, for any baby, you're just going to use enough so that there's no friction with your your hands on her body. She's not going to be greasy, in other words. Yeah.
She seems very happy and ready to go.
Yes, so we will get started. And the best thing is to remove any jewelry or watches or anything sharp that might Simone. So we'll go ahead and Julie will apply some oil to your hands and rub them nicely together. And we're going to start with Simone's head. And we're just going to go a nice gentle circles on the top of her head. And the sides of the head and the back. Nice, easy circles. And particularly real gentle around the soft spot or fontanelles. And this is real soothing and nourishing for your baby. Then you're going to come right down and do the little ears. Just a real gentle massage on her ears. That's great. Oh, she loves that.
She seems to like that very much, but what if a baby were fussing?
Well, she might be fussing, she might have some little gas or some kind of thing. So the main thing is that you just continue easily. By the end of the massage, she should be more relaxed and comfortable. Sometimes when you first begin to do the Abhyanga, a baby might not be used to it and there might be some fussing, but after 2-3 days, then she'll really be comfortable and enjoy it.
From the ears, you're just going to go right ahead to her little face. You're going to go back and forth on her forehead. And just little circles on the temples. And with your fingertips, go down the sinuses. And then little gentle circles on her cheeks. And across her lip and across the chin. That's beautiful. At this point, you might want to just go ahead and use a little more oil and rub your hands together again. And as you can see, Julia is just talking so sweetly and tenderly with Simone. It's a fun time. It's a play time. And it's a marvelous opportunity to really reinforce the love and the bonding that you have with your baby. So the next move, you've covered the head really well, the ears and the face. So now we'll go to her torso and the arms. You're going to sweep up her tummy, out her chest, and out her arms. That's beautiful. Very nice. And you're going to do that three times. Upper tummy, outer chest, and outer arms. That's wonderful. Beautiful.
Do you do this more than once a day?
It's great to do it ideally in the morning if it can fit into your routine. And then again in the evening, there's a very soothing and smoothing abhyanga that can be done with your baby. And a lot of times that's the one the fathers love to do so much because it's an opportunity to be very close with a baby and have real quality time.
That's a great time for me too because I help Art get all set up, put them in the bathroom, close the door, and I have time to myself. And it's a structured time for intimacy, and it's a time for me to have a break because often I read and I hear mothers don't have enough time to themselves. And I haven't had that because this is one time a day that's absolutely mine and theirs together. So it's a great time for all of us.
It's beautiful. Everyone comes out a winner.
Don't
and
you?
Then after the evening abhyanga, Simone will sleep even more sweetly and deeply. So following the three sweeps, upper torso and outer arms, then you do circles on her little arm and straight on the long bone area. So we'll just start with you can do one arm at a time.
Mm-hmm.
Little circles on the joint and straight on the long bone. Circles on the elbow. There you go. Back and forth on the forearm. Little thumbies inside her hand. Beautiful. And then the other arm. Excellent. It's very good for her muscle tone. It's really lovely also for releasing any tension and stress that may have been received in the fetal position. It just opens up the whole torso. Next is the tummy. We're going to go circles from the right to the left, starting at the lower right side and then over to the left. She just loves it. This is very good for digestion. Helps move along any little gas bubbles that might be there and causing her some discomfort. Now Simone is very strong. You can see she's arching her back and moving. And as Simone grows, Julia and Arnie growing with her as far as the abhyanga is concerned. It's a very dynamic, creative process. And Simone won't always be lying there as she is right now. And so she'll be sitting up and she'll be rolling over and she'll be crawling. And we want to incorporate her accomplishments in the abhyanga. It's a very dynamic experience. So we don't expect Simone to always be lying like this. So next we're going to do her legs. Get a little bit more oil. Rub your hands together. Oh, no. There you go.
Okay.
And sweep right down the legs three times. And have a little rattle handy in case she starts to fuss. There you go.
Let's get our legs. Come on, let's get our legs.
Three sweeps down. And again, the same idea as on the arms, doing three circles on the hips.
Here we go.
Three, and then back and forth on the thigh. And you can let your hand be just real easy around the thigh. You can do, with your hand, you can do the whole thigh. There you go. Circles on the knee. And then let your whole hand be around the calf, back and forth, just easy. And then the little foot. Go ahead and do the ankles, the Achilles tendon, and the heel. And on top of the foot, we just love those little feet. Okay, back and forth with your palm on the sole of the foot. That's excellent. Very good. And you do the same with the other leg, but we're going to go ahead and turn Simone over.
Yay!
Turn her on her tummy.
Okay.
There you go. Oh, that's a good girl.
She looks like she's done this before.
She just loves her
abhyanga. Back just this morning.
Okay. So we're going to have some more oil on your hands. And on her back, very important part of the physiology, we're going to go up and down, and the emphasis is on up. And just real gentle, soft hands. Real easy. Up and down. Very good. And this would go on her back for about 2-3 minutes. Then you come down and do a little bottom circles there. And you can include the back sweep with her bottom like that. And go up and back. And sweep all the way down the legs. Beautiful. A couple times all the way from the shoulders all the way down the legs. That's great. And as she grows, it's really nice to do some little thumb even massage, in particular on her calves, because as she's crawling and running, that little muscle gets kind of tight and it helps relax her. So one more really nice sweep all the way down. That's beautiful.
Now, do you shampoo the hair of the child after Abhyanga?
Well, you would, of course, cleanse and bathe her, and you can shampoo, use a very gentle soap for a new baby, and very mild, very gentle, and you can shampoo her hair about once a week.
Notice that you're using sesame oil. Is there a reason you use that as opposed to another kind of oil?
Traditional sesame oil is used for Abhyanga. It has got levels of penetration. It's very suitable for the nutritional value as well. For some reason the sesame oil is not suitable, then use coconut oil. And both of the oils can be purchased at a health food store.
Earlier you mentioned something about baby exercise as part of this program. We want to see those tiny aerobics, Clara. What's that all about?
Yes, these exercises are a wonderful way to end the whole sequence of Abhyanga bathing and then exercises. Their value are, they're very good for flexibility for your baby, good for neuromuscular integration, also helpful for digestion. So we'll go ahead with Simone and go through these exercises. And the first are just with her legs. You're going to put her knees to her tummy and back again. Again, repeat them 3 times. There you go. And that's good for her digestion. The next one is with her legs straight. You just put one hand over her knees, and the other hand you'll lift the legs up. Again, think in terms of 3. And it's just...
And they seem to have a wonderful relationship, our little coach and Blissful Baby here.
They're beautiful. Such an intimate relationship. Exercise is also with the legs. And you keep the legs straight, and then just cross one other. Again, 3 times. There you go. That's great. The next one is with the arm and the leg. All the way out the arm and leg all the way back, and cross them over her tummy. This one is very good for her muscle tone and flexibility, also for her neuromuscular integration. Then we'll do the other one. She just loves this. Very good. That's wonderful. It's such a fun time for mom and baby. It's great. And then the arms all the way closed in front and all the way out. And this is also, of course, when your baby is first born, the exercises are done and gently, and this one is particularly to relieve the muscular tension 9 months in the fetal position. So all the exercises are a marvelous benefit, and again, it's the sequence, the Abhyanga and bathing and then the exercises. Yeah. It gives an opportunity also for your baby to have some more air drying so that all the cracks can dry real comfortably and there's not so much chance of any diaper rash.
Well, thank you very much, Simone. Well done. I have some questions for Dr. Lonsdorf concerning the exercises and the massage. Dr. Lonsdorf, is there any time when you shouldn't give the baby a massage?
If the baby has a cold and has some congestion in the sinus area or in the chest, then it's best to wait until that's cleared up and then restart the daily Abhyanga at that time.
As a blissful father, you've been participating in this program, haven't you?
Yes, in the evenings I take Simone and allow Julia that time to herself, and it's a great time for me and Simone to get together and have that intimacy take place. I remember when I was at the time of birth, and it was quite an uncomfortable situation. I didn't know which way to hold her, and it was like she was sliding down, and with this time I'm just and learning how her muscles are growing and how to handle and changing diapers and things like that. It's quite a joy, and it's an experience that I wouldn't miss.
Happy that you're participating in the Blissful Father program.
Thanks.
Too.
I feel pretty blissful.
I think anyone watching our Martian baby massage demonstration couldn't help but notice that something very significant and profound was going on there. Other points provided from this expansive knowledge. Dr. Lonsdorf, what are some other important points we need to know about the care of our newborn?
Well, first of all, Anne, we have to remember that the baby has just spent 9 months in that very quiet, protective environment of the womb. So coming out into the world is quite a contrast. So we want to, in those first few weeks, decrease the sensory stimuli to the baby, the intense type of stimuli, like very bright lights or cold drafts. We want to keep the baby as comfortable as possible. For that reason, we generally recommend in Ayurveda that the baby and mother also spend as much time in the house as possible for 6 weeks, that it's a quieter environment, that if they want to go outside, they should do that when the weather is very mild. Try to stay in the immediate environment. Also, we recommend that visitation be kept down to a reasonable degree in the first weeks of life, that perhaps only immediate family or maybe an hour set aside during the day, a specific time, where visitors can come.
Very good. Margaret, what about recommendations regarding the feeding of a child?
Well, Ayurveda, for thousands of years, has recognized that breastfeeding is going to provide the most optimal nourishment for a newborn. And modern medicine has also come to the same conclusion. In fact, there are research studies demonstrating that a baby that has been nursed for at least 6 months will have much better resistance to illness. It receives antibodies from the mother through breast milk. In order to enhance nursing, one primary thing that a mother needs to do is to drink fluids, and especially valuable for this is milk. Milk helps to make. Sometimes this is a problem for some of our moms because some women have sensitivities towards taking milk, and Ayurveda has a very simple knowledge to overcome this milk sensitivity, which is to just bring milk to a boil before drinking, and then you can let it cool a bit before taking it. And also the mother can add common household spice such as a little pinch of ginger or cardamom, and this also helps in terms of the digestion of the milk.
What about the feeding schedule? Does Maharishi Ayurveda provide guidelines for that?
Basically, they recommend for at least the first 2 weeks of the baby's life to just go with a demand schedule. In other words, in order to get nursing well established, you want to let the baby nurse whenever it indicates the desire to nurse. After that, we recommend what we call a modified demand schedule, which would mean you're responsive to the baby's demands or needs, but you shouldn't feel that the baby really physically has a need to feed more often than every 2 hours. Many times, the only way the baby has to communicate to the mother is through crying, and the mother shouldn't always assume that a cry means the baby's hungry. Maybe they have a wet diaper, maybe they need a little change of activity. There are many different angles to take in terms of making the baby more happy, and the mother just needs to start to learn those signals from her baby and not always feel that a cry means she must immediately put the baby to the breast.
These are good points on nursing. Dr. Lonsdorf, what about the introduction of solid foods? What's the program for that?
Well, this is a good area for each mother to talk with your pediatrician and to follow his recommendations, but for the purposes of this tape, we can discuss the general Ayurvedic recommendations. We find that at around 5 to 6 months of age, babies are ready to start taking a more varied diet. This is usually the time at which the first teeth start to appear in the mouth too, as if it's a sign from nature that they're ready to start eating a more expanded diet. So the most reliable sign is from the baby himself, and that is that the baby is taking some interest in the food around him. He may be pointing at the food or crying out to eat off the mother or father's plate. So we honor that natural urge coming from the baby and start to expand the diet.
What foods would you recommend?
In choosing the first foods, Anne, we must remember that this is the first time the child's digestive system is taking anything other than mother's milk. So Ayurveda recommends beginning first with something which is very easy to digest and is also nutritious. A good first food to try is a broth made from rice or made with mung beans. We've included the recipe for these broths in the educational packet. It is also important to introduce only one food at a time. Try one food for 3 or 4 days so that the child can get used to it, and then the mother can also notice any type of reaction the child may have. Then after a week or two, then one progresses from liquids to the semi-solids. So at this time, we can introduce very well-cooked vegetables, sushi, or very ground-up types of things. We choose vegetables according to what the child seems to like. And many children are not fond of broccoli and other cabbage-type vegetables, so we really avoid those at this stage. Then as the child progresses in his diet, then he can move on to a very regular routine of 3 meals a day, in addition to the nursing times. Cow's milk can also be added to the diet at this time, generally around 8 months of age. Ayurveda recommends that when cow's milk is added, that it always be boiled first, even though it is pasteurized, because that allows the milk to be better digested. We generally cool the milk down to room temperature, just slightly warmer, before giving it to the child. It also, by boiling the milk in this way, helps to reduce any problem with mucus or congestion. And when we do add the cow's milk, we do so in just gradually increasing amounts. If there is any problem with it, then we consult the child's pediatrician and ask them more about it. Goat's milk may be an alternative that's suggested. And Ayurveda states that this is somewhat less nourishing than cow's milk, but it is easier to digest.
Are there any other foods that should be avoided?
Well, during early infancy, it is best to avoid very sour-tasting foods, such as grapefruits or strawberries. Also, bananas should not be given very frequently because they are very heavy, hard to digest, and can lead to more congestion problems. Also, we don't add very heavy meat, such as meat, or heavy foods, such as meat, fish, or eggs, until at about the age of 1. Many pediatricians also recommend not giving honey to children under the age of 1. And of course, no food should be given that the baby could choke on or have difficulty getting down, such as nuts or other not very easily chewed foods.
Very good. Margaret, what about weaning? What does Maharishi Ayurveda say about that?
Well, according to traditional Ayurvedic knowledge, it is felt that nature gives the signal for when it's most appropriate to start weaning, and this is really when the baby starts teething. Teething is found to begin happening between 6 to 11 months, so during this time, as the baby is starting to teethe, the mother can start introducing more solid foods, just one by one, very easily. In fact, it's many mothers express that they have difficulty in having weaning occur in a healthy and pleasant way, and many times this is because they have waited too long. As time progresses, the weaning can become an emotional issue for the child, whereas if the mother goes with the signal from nature in terms of the teething and starts the weaning by 11 months, then the child will just very easily go into more solid foods.
Now, some mothers nurse a little bit longer.
Yes, we always recognize that every mother has the best intuition for her own child. She has that love and that connection with the child that really gives her the signal that this time is for her to wean her baby.
Good. Yeah. Now, what about the baby's sleep? Where should the baby sleep, for one thing?
Traditionally, according to Ayurveda, it's considered most appropriate for the baby to sleep with the mother. This could either be right in bed with the mom. Many nursing moms find this so convenient when they're being wakened in the night to just have the baby right there, or the mother might want to place the child in a bassinet at the bedside. And then by approximately 12 months of age, can think of putting the child in a separate room from the parents.
up another subject not related, and that is it possible to spoil a child in the first 2 years? Are there any rules we schedule or whatever? What do you think, Dr.
Well, Lonsdorf? This is a very interesting question, and the Ayurvedic understanding of the mind-body relationship comes into play here. We know that relationship between mind and body. Modern medicine is beginning to explain in very concrete terms how the connection is made, and it has to do with that emotion, every feeling, every thought that we have is translated into molecules there in the brain, and then to molecules produced all over the body. We know, for example, if we're angry, then there's something, maybe our face gets red, sweating that might take place, heart pounding in the chest. There are all sorts of reactions that occur in the physiology. Likewise, with positive emotions, with happiness, there are physiological changes which are beneficial to the body. The body gets more settled, it functions more smoothly, more efficiently. They find even that the immune system in happy people is stronger, and people who are grieving is suppressed. So what we want to do in the context of mothers and babies, mothers and fathers and babies, is enhance the baby's immune system, enhance the baby's health through creating happy molecules, we could say, in the body, in the baby's body, by creating happy feelings in the baby. So all of the Ayurvedic approach to interaction with the baby and teaching the baby and helping the baby learn is through that bond of love, an expression always softness and respecting the baby's very tender emotions and very tender feelings.
What are the implications of this tour for discipline later on in life?
Well, of course, discipline is an extremely important part of raising children, teaching them what is proper and what is improper. Up until the age of 2, however, children, babies, it's been shown by scientific research, do not have that ability to comprehend prohibitions on their activity or that word no. It's very difficult for them to understand what that means and to incorporate that into their behavior. So the Ayurvedic approach is really to distract the baby. If there's something the baby wanting to do that's not proper for the baby, what we do is use that value of attention. We bring something more intriguing into the baby's span of attention, and the baby will naturally be attracted to what is right for them. And then by our positive feedback, then the baby gets encouraged just naturally to choose those things that are right for him or her. So it's really always discipline through that bond of love and through that bond of attention.
Very good. There's so much to learn from Maharshi Ayurveda. It's really an exciting area. Thank you so much. We're going to find out more about how to make you and your baby more blissful, more happy from the beginning all the way through life as we talk about prenatal care right after this.
We told you we'd have a panel of experts on Maharshi Ayurveda Mother Baby, and here it is. We have mothers and fathers and children who've been enjoying the benefits of this program for various times. We want to get their response to the actual application of this program. First of all, how long have some of you been doing the Abhyanga, the Maharshi Ayurveda baby massage?
I've been giving just the Abhyanga for about 23 months now.
20 months?
20 months, ever since he was about 2.5 months old. And he's enjoyed quite a bit. It doesn't really interfere with our program. I give to him every morning when he really likes to have it. Sometimes he can not go with it. Normally I give it to him every morning. And it takes about 5-10 minutes. And I do it in the bathroom or what, I can just put it right into the bathtub afterwards.
And that works out well?
Oh, very well, yes.
Very good. Now, Sheila, you have 2 children, different ages. Now, did you do Abhyanga for both children? Let's have a comparative report here.
Yeah, they're both over here. Dallas, who's now 4, we started with him when he was about 1.5 years. And Sylvia, she started when she was 1 week old. There was a considerable difference in terms of their first year of life. Dallas was colic and he was just real uncomfortable in his body during the first year and had a lot of colds and flu and that type of thing. And he didn't sleep well at all at night. And then when we started him with Abhyanga, it just completely changed. And for Celia, her first year of life was just really uncomfortable for her. She had no indigestion problems, no colic. She slept through the night almost from the beginning and was just a real calm, calm, easy baby.
But how about your relationship to your son, for instance, Paul? Did you strengthen that bonding, as Maharishi Ayurveda describes? Or?
Well, he appreciates what I'm doing to him, and so it does strengthen the bond between him and I. When I give him his Abhyanga afterwards, he seems to be more happier, and he is less restless. And because of that, that makes his whole day a better day, which makes my day a better day. And
that's super interesting. Blissful fathers and blissful babies.
Yeah.
Yes.
I think that the investment that I spend in the time to do their Abhyanga is, how do I say it, that just makes up for time that if they were sick, I'd have to be spending taking care of them, holding them, going to the doctor's office, waiting for the doctor, and things like that. And they're just immensely healthy. I mean, everyone who sees them, they say, oh, look at those babies, and aren't they the healthiest babies you ever saw? And they really, I mean, they do, they look healthy to me, and I'm sure that the Abhyanga has a large part to do with that.
Life is very busy, but I felt that this was such a priority that I always want to do it myself, even though I have someone helping me and I could have somebody else do it for me. I feel like it's such an important time for the baby and I, and such an important time overall for her health and well-being, that we never miss.
In the earlier section, we saw how valuable the Maharishi Ayurveda baby massage was, and we want you to know that it's been good for grown-ups as well. So we invited to demonstrate the adult Abhyanga. But first we want Dr. Lonsdorf to tell us some of the values of the adult Abhyanga. Dr. Lonsdorf?
Well, and the Abhyanga is something which is suitable for people of all ages. And in fact, Ayurveda prescribes a daily oil massage or Abhyanga for adults as well. And it should be included as part of their daily routine each morning. The benefits of the Abhyanga for adults are similar as for those for children. It helps to relieve muscular tension that builds up. It helps to improve circulation. It's said in the Ayurvedic text to even improve the functioning of the immune system. So by including this in the daily routine, the adult has a rejuvenation procedure that they can enjoy each day. And Ayurveda also describes that it's very important to help reduce the influence of aging and wear and tear on the body. And besides that, it's very important.
Very good. Claire, would you like to introduce Kathy and narrate our demonstration?
I'd be happy to. This is Kathy Poole, and she'll be showing us how to do the Abhyanga for an adult. As with the baby's Abhyanga, you start with the head. And with Kathy, she's doing a dry Abhyanga. At home, you would be using sesame oil. Again, using a plastic bottle with a flip top, and you can warm it in hot water so it's a nice comfortable temperature. So you notice Kathy's doing circles on her head, around the top, on the sides, and in the back. Just easy circles. Around to the face, back and forth on the forehead, and then circles on the temples, circles on the cheeks, back and forth on the sinuses, over the chin, and over the lip. Also, you want to be sure and get those ears, those little ears, little gentle massage on the outside of the ears, not going inside. That's great. Then doing the neck real nicely, going real gently up the neck, and also getting the back of the neck. Pay even a little more attention. People have some tension in the neck, and just feel free to give it a lot of attention. You're going right over to the right arm, and you're going to be massaging the shoulder over that trapezius muscle. And again, if there's some tension there, feel free to spend a little bit of time, and just back and forth. And circles on the shoulder, back and forth on the upper arm, on the elbow, back and forth on the forearm. Again, there's circles on the joints and back and forth on the bone area. and attention to the hand, going back up to the inner arm, back and forth, again in the long breath, circles around the joints, back and forth on the forearm, paying attention to the palm, thumbs inside the palm, just back and forth, and then pulling the fingers real gently. And then she's just finally a sweep off on that arm. And going to the other arm, again doing the trapezius muscle, the shoulder, circles on the shoulder, and back and forth on the upper arm, and circles on the elbow, back and forth on the forearm, and just easy on the hand. Doing the upper arm, back and forth, circles on the elbow, back and forth on the forearm, on the wrist, and then getting the palm again real nicely. It feels really good, especially after working with our hands every day, and so that feels so good. Pulling the fingers, that's great. That's real nice. Then you're going to do circles on the chest and around the breath, circles and around. And right down, back and forth, real gently over the heart. That's very nice, very helpful, very, very gentle. Then on the abdomen, starting in the lower right where the bowel starts, going from right to left, very gentle. By this time, you'd probably want to apply more oil to your hands and just be real easy over the abdomen. And then the back, reach back as far as you can, circles on the back, and then up and down on either side of the spine, just as far as you can comfortably reach. And then Kathy's going back and forth on her sides. Again, on the sides, you go up and down as comfortably as you can reach. Starting on the right leg, circles on the hip, and then you can really cover the whole thigh with both hands. You notice that Kathy's using one hand on the top, one hand on the bottom, circles on the knee, and then the calf. Again, doing the whole leg with both hands, back and forth. Then doing the foot, circles on the ankles, on the Achilles tendon, then on the heel, on the top of the foot, in between the toes. Then on the back of the foot, using the full palm of the hand. Ayurveda is very keen on using the full palm especially, and using some thumbs to really work the feet. Feet work hard every day, so we just love the feet. We work them and give them a nice massage. Then we'll go over to the left leg, again starting with circles on the hip, back and forth on the thigh, circles on the knee, back and forth on the calf, and again doing the foot very thoroughly. You see Kathy's doing the ankles, then she'll do Achilles tendon, heel. In the evening, it's helpful to do your feet before going to bed. It's very nice, give a nice restful sleep. So again, between the toes. And doing the sole of the foot back and forth with the palm of the hand over the whole foot. The whole Abhyanga takes only a few minutes, about 5 to 10 minutes. Ideally, it's done in the morning. And usually men and women like to morning to be fresh, and this takes just a few minutes before that. It's just a natural addition to the regular routine, and the benefits are just wonderful.
Kathy, what is the value of this massage to a pregnant woman?
Well, ladies, when they are pregnant, they're carrying much more weight. They sometimes start to feel more stiff during pregnancy. They can't do as much exercise as perhaps they did formerly. And the massage is an effect of giving a more limber feeling to the whole physiology. But additionally, it's
for the physiology. People feel a very nice, relaxed feeling. It also enhances circulation, which is just for the general health, strengthening to the immune system. It also felt to be helpful in preventing stretch marks. We do recommend for the moms, however, that if they they don't rub vigorously in this area, just very gently apply the oil to the abdominal area.
Considering pregnancy, Dr. Lonsdorf, what other guidelines does Maharshi Ayurveda recommend?
Pregnancy is, of course, a very special time in a woman's life. It's a time that many women, it's a time when women themselves feel more protective of their own physiology, and often people also are more protective of them. They open doors for them and try to make them very comfortable. But changes remind us that something very special is happening, and that you, the pregnant woman, are very careful to make sure that the influences on your physiology are very soothing. And very, we know that, of course, for example, smoking and drinking are very negative and have very developing baby. And even certain types of Ayurveda should be favored, and certain types of food should be avoided as much as possible. In general, Ayurveda recommends a very balanced diet, one that is nutritious, one that's fresh, avoiding leftovers as much as possible, and of course very delicious that the woman enjoys eating. And because the body is so extra sensitive at the time, heavy foods are very strong foods like garlic, onions, and very strong spices. Of course, the most important thing is for the woman to be as fresh as possible, to avoid stressful situations.
Are there any foods that you recommend for the pregnant woman?
Yes, there are, Anne. In fact, there are several types of foods, and these are ones that are said to have an especially nourishing effect on the pregnant baby. And these include butter, rice, whole milk, dates, raisins, and clarified butter. Clarified butter is also called ghee. It's spelled G-H-E-E. And it's said to be really balancing for the woman at this time. Now, of course, a woman should take a very varied and balanced diet. But these are some of the foods that she should make a little more effort to try to include on a daily basis.
Certain cravings that the pregnant woman has, you know, pickle and ice cream in the middle of the night and things like
right.
this. Is there any physiological basis to these?
Well, Ayurveda says yes, that definitely the cravings that a woman has, those desires she experiences, actually reflect some need in the developing baby or in her own physiology at that time. Something unusual, like pickles and ice cream, or something that they normally take in diet, but is they're desiring more of it at that time. So the general guideline is women to eat more of that special food or to eat that strange food they're craving precaution that they examine that with common sense and that in the context of a balance.
It sounds like a fun prescription.
Sure.
We'll follow up on that. Exercise during pregnancy. And today's modern active woman, we see her skiing, scooping, shooting. What is the ideal exercise program during her pregnancy?
Well, it is true that more women are being encouraged, or at least told that it's all right for them to be involved vigorously during pregnancy. And certainly a woman who has been very athletic prior to right. this continued the during pregnancy in terms of the Ayurvedic understanding, there's much more thought of protecting the fetus. The mother's much more at this time. She's a little more vulnerable, and therefore the fetus is also more vulnerable. To protect her health and the baby's health, especially, it's more appropriate for her to be in activities that aren't as strenuous, something like walking, especially in the fresh air, or swimming, or some type of light activity is considered more appropriate Ayurvedically.
Lonsdorf, what other things would you like to mention for our pregnant viewers?
There's really a wealth of information that Ayurveda gives on pregnancy and how to promote proper development of the baby. And let me summarize one other important point. We've talked a lot about the approaches from the level of the body, but Ayurveda also emphasizes the great importance of the state of mind of the mother, consciousness, and the relationship of mind and body that we've talked about so far comes into play here. We know that every emotion and every thought that we have in our minds has a corresponding physiological or biochemical component that influences the whole physiology. We talked about all the changes that occur, for example, if we're angry or if we're happy. So the point here is that we want to promote those very health-giving good chemicals, those so-called happy molecules or happy cells in the body. Because at this point, we're not just influencing our own physiology as a pregnant woman, but we're influencing the physiology of our baby. So at this time, we want to be careful to have our attention on very happy thoughts, very uplifting topics, things that improve our state of mind.
Well, what sort of situations do you mean?
For example, it would be recommended that a woman not be watching voluntarily movies or television shows, for example, that are very violent or create fear, are very intense in their nature. Rather, she should watch things that are uplifting, ideas about children and families, and she should have in her mind all those things that she wants for her baby and her family.
Well, you're always encouraging the mother to be happy and all that, but you can't really be going around all day thinking about happiness and how you can be happy and all that.
Right.
What do you recommend?
That's a good point, Anne. Happiness can't just be a mood or something that we pretend. It has to be something very genuine. And the most important prescription that Maharshi Ayurveda gives is to practice the TM, or Transcendental Meditation Technique, because in this way, we help reduce that stress that can be there in the nervous system and can block those natural feelings of happiness and joy that we might normally experience. So just by practicing TM and just living life very simply and innocently, then we'll have that inner state of well-being that we're looking for.
We really found the regular practice of Transcendental Meditation to be one of the most beneficial things a pregnant woman can do for herself and her growing baby. In fact, those same babies grow to be 2, 3, and 4 years old, and they might notice that their mother is becoming a bit frazzled, a little fatigued, and they will go ahead and say, "Mom, it's time to meditate, Mom."
Good suggestion.
Yeah.
Well, now, a mother is very busy. A pregnant woman has to change her schedule and all that. Is TM practical? Is it difficult to learn? The time consideration? What do you think about that?
It's very easy to learn. It takes like 15-20 minutes in the morning and evening. There are Transcendental Meditation Centers really all over the world. In the U.S., just look in the white pages or yellow pages under Transcendental Meditation and introductory lectures and so forth. Very systematic procedure for learning the program.
Very good. Now, what about the role of the father in the pregnancy? Sometimes they feel a little bit useless. They're on the sidelines during all of this. So what can they do? How can they participate in this blissful program?
Ayurvedically speaking, they really encourage the father to think in terms of his role as nurturing and support of the mother. Just as with the mother-baby program itself, we always like to say that through nurturing the mother, she can better nurture her baby. And just in this way, the father, by that protection and security and ease for his wife, he's going to give the optimal outcome for the whole family.
So his job is to see that she is happy. Mm-hmm. That's a good profession. I like that.
Sounds good, doesn't it?
Yes, absolutely. Well, I think our viewers are getting the idea that this is a very unique time for a very delicate condition, physiologically speaking. Before we leave this section, do you have any last points here for the pregnant mothers?
Well, I'd like to just re-emphasize that this is a time when there are many, many physiological changes taking place in the woman's physiology. And it's a time when she may feel more fatigue than usual. In fact, early in the pregnancy and then again later in the pregnancy are especially times when this fatigue may come up. And today, in our day of working on the hospital wards or in the office till the day before delivery, that's very much in vogue. However, Ayurveda would say that we should honor that sign from the body that the body needs more rest. And honoring that means even taking time off work. Maybe we would like to even plan the month or two before the baby is delivered, that they take some time off, time to rest. In fact, Ayurveda says that's a very important time for the baby's final development, nourishment, to have the mother as rested and fresh possible. So she shouldn't feel that she's bathing herself. She should really honor that physiological need.
Be responsible with her to her child.
And one last point I wanted to make, because it's so very important, is the idea that everything that the mother ingests at this time has an influence not only on her physiology, but on her developing baby. Therefore, Veda says that ingesting means not just through the mouth, but also through all the senses. We talked about the value of having an attention on uplifting topics, listening to music that is enjoyable to us, not loud and jarring, having exercise that's very soothing to the physiology, not jarring, for example. And then again, to reemphasize the value of fresh, wholesome foods, meaning even optimally, foods prepared without chemicals and preservatives. It should be so fresh that there should be no need for these extra chemicals. And of course, it goes without saying now with all the scientific research on the deleterious effects of smoking and alcohol that women avoid these things, as well as all drugs and chemicals, unless they've been prescribed specifically for her by her physician.
Very good.
Mm. Another thing many pregnant ladies find especially comforting is to spend time in the company of women who are mothers. Just provides a real supportive feeling. It's very nurturing to the heart and the emotional state.
Very educational. Sure.
Something else that's really quite helpful, we have seen how to do the Abhyanga, how a woman does the Abhyanga. And for a pregnant woman, this is especially important. It's helping her, revitalizing her physiology. And in the or in the months as she grows bigger in certain areas of her body, her tummy larger, many of the mothers have told me that they've found some benefit by using coconut oil and just gently rubbing these areas somewhat with stretch marks. And then in the 8th month, it's good to use sesame oil and massage the nipples, and this is very helpful in preparation for nursing.
If we followed all these principles outlined by Maharishi Ayurveda, it sounds like those 9 months could be the greatest 9 months of a woman's life.
Sure. I've heard that.
Very good. We have more knowledge from Maharishi Ayurveda regarding the postpartum period coming up next. We have some more graduates of the mother-baby program here. We want to get their opinions on it. Ellen, maybe you could tell us a little bit about what you think Maharishi Ayurveda mother-baby program from your perspective. I know you had sort of a unique situation.
Well, I had a C-section, which I wasn't expecting, of course, and I was a little bit out of balance, I would say mildly, after I had the baby. This is my first baby, and I've always been a little bit out of balance before my monthly cycle. And this, I knew, would be another cause of a little bit of imbalance. In any case, the mother-baby program was remarkable to me. I don't know how any woman can have a baby and become normal again without it. Every aspect of the program I found to be completely nourishing, completely directed at returning the mother to normality. At the beginning I thought, how am I going to be able to handle a baby when I don't feel comfortable myself, and I'm generally a very stable person, and emotionally stable as well as very active in the day. And I thought, this is too much, it's overwhelming. And every day of the mother-baby program brought me to a more and more, a greater level of ease, a greater level of comfort with myself, and greater confidence in myself as a mother. And I feel that it was just getting the physiology back to normal, which is what was absolutely necessary. The diet I still follow to a great extent because it's very nourishing. I felt it was very good for me as well as the baby, and made him a healthier baby.
Lonsdorf talked a lot about the importance of balance in Maharishi Ayurveda, all the programs. Could maybe some of the other comment on how Maharishi Ayurveda Mother Baby Program has restored balance in your postpartum period?
Well, I have a comparison between my first and second pregnancies. With pregnancy, there was no mother baby program, and I would say that it took me a good 6 to 9 months to actually take place, just to feel comfortable internally. And after I had my second child and I was doing the mother-baby program, I'd say by the end of the 6 weeks, my whole physiology just felt healthier, clearer, and I was completely back to normal. And so there was this wonderful balance that took place immediately in my life. And I also noticed it in the baby. There was my infant, that there was just complete balance and harmony within his physiology, with the colic or waking up all hours of the night. And it was different in the first and second child.
What about weight loss? That's a big concern to a lot of mothers, psychologically and physiologically.
When I had Cecil and started going through this program, I started feeling and after a period of about 3 weeks, I felt like I'd never even had a baby. You know, it was so wonderful. Mm-hmm. And by the end of the 6 week period, I was 10 pounds less than when I got pregnant. Better than I had in so long. It was just a remarkable experience for me.
What value do you see in your family? What changes?
The second child, so much easier, and it really, she deserved that it'd be that way. Deserve this, and I was very happy that it was available to provide for her. So, fantastic.
Now, what things do you participate in? I mean, do you do baby Abhyanga?
I personally kind of, you know, my family's at a different house before they're even waking up, so I don't get a chance to participate. Although, when we were doing it for the first, I'd say, first 4 or 5 months of his life, there were times when I really wanted hands-on with the Abhyanga, because really the intimacy that's naturally there between the child and the mother, or the child and the father, while this is going on, is something to be cherished forever. So I did participate when I can, but right now routine has changed that.
Very good. How about your family?
My husband actually has been doing his Abhyanga since he was a month old in the morning, and I do the one in the evening. And this has been going on now. He's 11 months old. And I think the bonding that was created between the two, this hands-on, as you call it, but the time they spend together in this kind of intimate way, the young, and then the bath afterwards, and the playing that goes along with it, has created a relationship which I just cherish. Watch them together. My two guys just have a very special, sweet relationship. And while it's taken time out of my husband's schedule, I feel that the benefit that he gained, and the softness too, has been tremendous. I think the time has been worth it, and I think it's been worth it myself, just from the wife and mother's point of view.
We've discussed pregnancy, prenatal care, the importance of health in that period of life. Now let's assume that we have proud parents with a blissful baby returning home, start a whole new period in life, the postpartum time. What advice does Maharishi Ayurveda provide for that time?
And I think to fully understand this postpartum period, we need to have a clear understanding of the woman's physiology according to Ayurveda. Ayurveda describes that the physiology is governed by three fundamental metabolic principles. These are called doshas, and each of the doshas is responsible for certain functions within the body. The three doshas are named on, and they go by their original Sanskrit names: Vata dosha,
Pitta dosha and Kapha dosha. Now, Vata dosha, in one word, is responsible for movement in the body, Pitta for metabolism, and for structure. Now, we'll go into that a little bit more deeply. Now, we understand these doshas not as physical in the body, but as an underlying expression of that intelligence operating all the time within our physiology. Intelligence gets channeled in certain directions. So Vata dosha is responsible within the body for all movement, including all the movement of the joints and the muscles, but also all circulation, the movement of the blood through the blood vessels. Also all of the nervous system activity. Pitta dosha is responsible for heat and metabolism. Digestion. So all of the enzymatic processes related to our digestion and then burning that food, even down to the level of the different cells in our tissues, that's all governed by this Pitta dosha, this heat and metabolic element. And then lastly, we have the Kapha dosha, which relates to fluid balance and structure in the body. So Kapha governs all the aspects of strength in the body and cohesion. All of the in the body that lubricate the joints, that add to the food as we swallow it and as it gets digested. So Kapha dosha has to do with strength and the fluids in the body. So we can see that with each of these three doshas, they have very important roles to play in the body. And everyone has these doshas operating very naturally and spontaneously in them all of the time. If these doshas are balanced and functioning normally, those metabolic principles and metabolic pathways are functioning normally, and the person's in good health, is feeling a state of inner strength and well-being. If the doshas are out of balance in some way, it can be one of the doshas or two of the doshas or all three, that creates some sense of dis-ease in the body, some symptoms eventually crop up, and eventually, if not corrected early, would lead to some illness or disease. So all three doshas are involved in pregnancy and delivery. The most important dosha during this postpartum time is Vata dosha. And as you recall, Vata governs the nervous system and all movement and flow in the body. And as we said before, Vata dosha is most important in keeping all of the doshas in balance, the entire system balanced. So during pregnancy and delivery, Vata dosha is very active because Vata governs movement and flow in the body. And at this time, there's this increased circulation through the baby's circulation. And then during delivery, all the movement of the baby down the birth canal and actually pushing the baby out into the world, it all involves this activity of Vata dosha. So we might expect that at this time, Vata dosha may get a little aggravated. And then we add on top of the whole delivery process, we add lack of sleep that comes about in the first few weeks postpartum, the increased demands on emotions and on the irregularity in our daily routine. All of these things can also tend to aggravate Vata dosha.
Would this by any chance be related to what we know as postpartum fatigue and postpartum depression?
Absolutely. Ayurveda understands this postpartum depression as coming about due to the imbalance that can grow in the if she's not taking proper care of herself at this time. So it's a very important time to pay special attention to the daily routine, the oil massage in the morning. Now, mothers at this time may find even 5 minutes for themselves to be difficult, but I think with the help of dad and any of the relatives around, mother can soon be spending an extra 5 or 10 minutes in the morning to take that oil massage and then a nice warm bath after, which really has a pacifying or balancing effect on Vata dosha.
Now, women have been giving birth for centuries, and most of heard the term Vata, much less what to do to pacify it. Are we sort of implying that there's been something very important missing in life?
Well, And pregnancy and delivery is a very normal and natural process in the body. However, there are a few simple steps that we can take to ensure that we don't incur imbalance from undergoing this challenging period for our physiology. We need to keep the physiology very strong at this time so that this imbalance doesn't grow. And in fact, many women later on in life, maybe a few years after delivery, relate some symptoms or problems as having started at this time when they got so exhausted, so tired, that some imbalance started at that time. So we be very careful at this time to get a little extra rest. We get some help perhaps from family members at this time, so we can really take care of ourselves.
We have a few more clips coming up next.
In my practice as a family practitioner, I've experienced several instances of postpartum depression, sometimes so severe requiring hospitalization. There are several theories as to why patients experience this depression after delivering. Some of them have to do with the endocrine changes and the increased responsibility of the new mother. The Maharishi Ayurveda mother-baby program structures rest and bonding and guidelines that make the birth and the postpartum period what it should be, enjoyable and very natural and happy for both mother and the baby. I've yet to experience any of my patients going through this program experiencing any postpartum depression symptoms.
One thing I think we know but often overlook in modern medicine is that delivery is a tremendous transition, both for the mother and, of course, for the baby. And what the Maharishi Ayurveda Mother and Baby Program does is just help to smooth out the transition, to make it easier, more comfortable, and actually joyful for the mother, and to make it much easier and more comfortable for the baby. And as a result, what we've seen is that the babies seem to do better. They have fewer childhood problems or early childhood problems, such as colic and sleep disorders, and they just seem to be happier and to develop in a very, very profound way.
It's most clear when you're seeing mothers who've had babies before, who've not gone through the mother-baby program. Then they can give a report, which is a comparison of how they feel after going through the program. It's a subjective experience that the mothers report of well-being, more energy, vitality, and happiness. They feel that their bodies are younger after the mother-baby program than they were before they were pregnant that time. So it really is an experience of new vitality and energy. You know, a mother really wants to have that as a platform when she starts out with this baby. She wants to have that zest and love of life and not an experience of fatigue and drain. That's often the case when mothers don't.
Most people recognize that the prenatal time is very important, very crucial to the future of the mother and baby's health and happiness. And so what you're suggesting is that that postpartum period be set aside as being very significant and unique also. Margaret, are there certain guidelines that Maharishi Ayurveda suggests that women should follow at this time?
I think this point of rest is really the most important to remember for any new mother and for the family. So in 20th century life, we have so many extra responsibilities. So many women are now in the workforce. They have professional responsibilities as well as their household responsibilities. And often it's easy to feel overwhelmed. And it's really important for every mother to, by taking care of herself, she'll be better able to take care of the baby. And to always put that rest for herself first, to realize that those first weeks and that period, initial period after delivery, she really needs to take care of herself, and rest is really the basis of that. I'd like to just mention my own personal experience as a mother. When I delivered twins, and so I had an even extra experience of fatigue from that experience. And for myself, what I realized is when you get extremely tired, often that there's a nervous fatigue that comes where you're so wound up that even when you want to relax and lay down and take a nap, you can't. You're too tired to even fall asleep properly. And what I found especially beneficial was to do my TM technique at that time. It enabled me to sit down and meditate and really relax, and I could just feel that deep rest coming into my system. And then after, if I had time, I could lay down and settled, I was relaxed, and I could really settle into a good sleep. So I would also encourage any mother to consider doing TM as a nice adjunct to taking care of herself.
This sounds very ideal. I can hear some of the mothers thinking what happens to the dishes in the meantime, the laundry's overflowing, and all the other duties. Do you have any other advice on what should go on in the daily routine?
Yes, it is a time, actually, during pregnancy, and father, to sit together and think ahead for those very delicate and crucial weeks following. If they can afford it, it's ideal to have some help, to hire someone to come and work in cooking, or it's beautiful time for the family and friends to participate. It's a very loving time in the whole family, and it's a wonderful opportunity for the whole family to pitch in. But again, if that doesn't work out logistically, it's wise if it's affordable to hire someone to really help. And of course, dad would pitch in as much as possible. It's a very dynamic time for the new mother, inside and out. It's out of sight, actually, what's going on, the reorganization of physiology, and so her attention should be with herself, giving very loving and nurturing attention to her baby, and she shouldn't have to worry about the practical necessities of cleaning and cooking, but they should be. And so planning ahead and organizing that is the best way that's accomplished.
Also, Anne, that value of rest can't be emphasized strongly enough. But the physiological demands on a mother of nursing are equivalent to the demands on the physiology of jogging 10 miles a day. And when you consider also that the woman's sleep is being interrupted every 2 to 3 hours around the clock week after week, you can imagine the fatigue and patient that starts to develop in her physiology. And again, this is where the baby program fills such a need for new mothers. And I really feel Ayurveda is an ancient knowledge with very 20th century application. Modern medicine doesn't really have a specific knowledge for this. The trend is toward shorter and shorter hospital stays. It's about 24-hour discharge after delivery, and the mother goes right on her own. Maybe dad's around when he's not at work, but there's just that lack. We also have so many more women in the workforce than ever before who are trying to get themselves back together to go back to work. So there are all these 20th century demands on not knowledge outside of Ayurveda to really help them back to a stronger place and really rejuvenate their whole system.
Well, part of rejuvenation must have something to do with diet. What about postpartum diet recommendations by Maharishi Ayurveda?
Ayurveda feels that diet is extremely important for every individual, and especially important at this critical time in the woman's physiology. In Ayurveda, very intimate connection and understanding of the relation between physiology and the environment. So what a woman takes in her body is extremely important as to how her physiology will be functioning. Ayurveda describes that what we do actually when we eat is take in intelligence. We take in that intelligence, that nourishment from food, and then taking it into our digestive system, it gets converted into intelligence and energy and governs and allows our physiology to function properly. So it is extremely important, especially at this time.
What factors does Ayurveda use to determine what diet would be appropriate for each constitution?
During delivery and postpartum, the Vata dosha is most predominant. This time, our diet should be such as to help bring Vata dosha back into balance. And we can understand that by recalling some of the qualities
of Vata dosha. For example, Vata tends to be cold, dry, and rough. So we remember those three qualities. What we do with our diet is try to counteract those by giving an influence which is warm, oily or unctuous, and very smooth and soothing to the physiology. So therefore, the diet that we'll follow at this time will be of warm, cooked foods, more oils in the diet, and very soothing, soft kinds of foods. We'll describe that. It's described, actually, in the booklet that the educational package you have.
Are there some specific do's and don'ts for new mothers?
In the workbook provided, Anne, we present this complete diet, which is the Vata pacifying diet. However, right now, we'll go over some of the most important points. First of all, if you're hungry in the morning, then you should eat breakfast. But it should be something light and something warm. We recommend cream of wheat or cream of rice, some hot cereal, which is both very easy to digest and also very soothing for the digestive tract. So we take it with a little warm milk, a small amount of clarified butter or ghee, and some brown or raw sugar according to your taste. Is both very nourishing and it is also very pacifying or balancing for Vata dosha. Secondly, we try beginning lunches with something, again, quite light. A freshly made soup, for example, with a teaspoon of ghee added. You may notice that ghee or clarified butter is recommended to be included as an important part of the diet at this time. Ghee has some special properties of being particularly balancing to Vata dosha, while at the same time it's very easy to digest and is strengthening to the entire physiology. So for this reason, it's an ideal oil to include in your diet. Of course, ghee being made from butter does have cholesterol in it. So if you have a cholesterol problem, then you should be more moderate and consult your physician in the use of the ghee. In addition to soup, all meals should favor both very warm and settling, nourishing foods. Again, fresh food is the ideal, trying to avoid leftovers whenever possible. And some examples are found on the diet sheets. The third point would be not to overeat at any meal. We want to make sure we give the body enough nourishment, but we don't want to overload the digestive tract. Also, because the digestive tract is more sensitive at this time, we want to favor lighter, easily digested foods. For this reason, we would recommend in the first 4 to 6 weeks after delivery to favor a more vegetarian diet. Now, if you're used to eating all types of meats, that would mean cutting back especially on the red meats, on pork and beef, trying to favor lighter meat. And if you have been eating maybe just chicken and fish, trying to introduce a few meals that are entirely vegetarian. That would be much easier on your entire system at this time. And the fourth point would be that cold foods and drinks, because they increase Vata in the system or aggravate Vata, should be avoided as much as possible. We should have warm and nourishing foods and warm drinks whenever possible, even with the meals. No ice water, have room temperature water, or even warm water, or a soothing tea without caffeine in it. Whole milk is especially good for nursing mothers, and it's very soothing and very enjoyable, actually, to take it warm. We can add a little ghee and a little sugar to it as well. Some cardamom or a pinch of ginger will also make it even more tasty and easier to digest. And then I just recommend to all the mothers to be sure to review the diet which is given in the educational packet. It's not something that has to be followed extremely strictly. It should be something that we use as a guideline. We're very comfortable with it, but we keep that in mind intellectually, that those are the kinds of choices that we will make in order to make our physiology as strong and as balanced as possible.
I can't help but ask you this question because I know it's a great concern to many new mothers, and that is concerning the weight gain during pregnancy. What is the best way to reduce this excess weight, Dr. Lonsdorf?
Well, the answer to this may surprise you, Anne, but it lies not so much in what food the mother is eating, how much food she's taking, really in the strength of her digestion. The Ayurveda describes that at this time, during pregnancy, delivery, and postpartum, the digestive tract gets more delicate, not as strong as it was before. So we could liken the digestive tract to a fire. If the fire gets low, then wood that's put on the fire doesn't get burned completely. The same in the digestive tract. If the digestive strength is less, then the food we put in is not completely metabolized or not completely utilized by the body, and the result is that weight is the head of the body. So really, the approach in Ayurveda is to strengthen the digestive tract and to encourage that metabolic fire to increase at this time.
So the best way to lose weight is not by dieting, but through proper nutrition.
Absolutely. In fact, to put additional strain on the physiology and the digestive tract by going on a strict diet actually defeats the purpose. It makes the problem worse. So at this time, the mother should pay special attention to her nutrition, follow the guidelines that we've given as what foods are most balancing for her, and in this way, she's going to naturally lose those pounds as the weeks go by.
Sounds almost too good to be true. It's a good program.
It does sound like it's like that way, but truly, when you look in all of nature, there's a principle of least effort. And so many new mothers have told me that by following these simple steps of the Abhyanga in the morning and following the dietary recommendations and the guidelines, the whole system comes into balance and the weight comes off easily and effortlessly with really in a very simple way. And so we see that creating balance in the physiology is the basis of creating good health. And one part of that is to regain one's proper weight, and oftentimes even better than before the pregnancy.
Good. Very important nutritional advice.
Yes, Anne. There are some very important additions to the diet which we recommend at this time. And these are very natural herbal food supplements. Now, there are some herbal food supplements which are specific for the woman's physiology at this time and have been used for thousands of years in this Ayurvedic tradition of taking care of the mother after she delivers a baby. These herbal food supplements are specifically strengthening for her physiology at this time. Now, in addition to these specific herbs, there is also a very special herb called Maharshi Amrit Kalash, which is actually a combination of several plants and herbs. This comes in the category of rasayana, which means that which nourishes and strengthens the physiology. Now, rasayanas have traditionally been given in Ayurveda to people to help to promote strength and to promote longevity. So they're very good for any person, but especially at this time after delivery, when the woman's physiology is in such need of a specific nutrition, it's very, very good for her to take this Maharshi Amrit Kalash at this time. So that's our primary recommendation in terms of a food supplement for the mother.
Good. So we've talked about mother and restoring balance in her life, and baby is restoring balance in his. What about father? What should be the role of father in the postpartum period?
Well, I think many fathers have the experience that when there's a new little baby in the house, they feel really left out and isolated. The mother is so wrapped up in all the physical needs of her baby and the round-the-clock nursing, and there's just this huge emotional attachment towards this beautiful little being that often she is not able to put the usual amount of attention on her husband as before. And so many times dad feels really left out. And one thing that's really beautiful about the Ayurveda baby massage is this is an opportunity for him to be very personally and intimately involved with the new baby. It strengthens his bond since he doesn't have the opportunity to nurse. But I think the really most valuable role that the father can play is just that support for the mother and the baby in the environment. And he can structure the environment so that it is nurturing and protective for his family. He can make certain that his wife remembers to take rest when she needs it. He can organize the household, whether it's through having friends come in or a close family member or even hiring someone, so that she doesn't have to worry about those household chores of cooking and cleaning. Someone else can worry about that. She can really focus on the baby and on her husband.
It's also very important for the mother and father to give equal attention to other children in the family. It's a time of reorganization in the family. There's new relationships. The older children have to relate to the younger baby and to the whole dynamics of the family. And so oftentimes it's not easy for the mother who has her whole attention on the new baby. And so it's an opportunity again for the father to spend more time with the older children, perhaps take them to dinner and special outings that they really enjoy together. And it's ideal if the mother can have just even one time a day when she'd be one-on-one with each of the other older children, so the older children don't feel deprived of the mother. They know they're going to have a very precious and loving time together with not the baby there, but just each of them together. And that is very fulfilling for the children and for the whole structure of the family.
So restoring balance to the family as a whole.
Exactly.
Sounds very much like all the principles of Maharishi Ayurveda. Mm-hmm. Thank you so much. I've been absolutely fascinated by this very profound and practical knowledge that Maharishi Ayurveda provides for families everywhere. Thank you all for participating in this.
Well, thank you, and I know for me it's been a tremendous pleasure to participate in this discussion and participate in the mother-baby program. I've seen difference in the recovery of the patients that I work with compared to my former obstetrical practice, what I see with the rejuvenation that these mothers experience through this beautiful knowledge.
I wholeheartedly agree, Anne, that this program has been extremely fulfilling to me as a health professional to be able to offer something that's nourishing and so practical, rather than just treating disease once it comes up, to really offer a preventative package and one that enhances the woman's life. We find, of course, that some of these procedures and recommendations may be a little different. They're not something that we heard about before, but in my experience, it's really extremely valuable to these women in recovering from the pregnancy and the postpartum period, and I'm sure that all of the ladies who follow this will find that they get those benefits for themselves.
On behalf of all of us, we'd like to wish all the new mothers and fathers and beautiful babies perfect and happiness and very great fulfillment.
And I'm Ann Adams. It's been my pleasure to be with you today to present Bissful Baby, the Maharishi Ayurveda Mother-Baby Program. If you'd like more information about the Transcendental Meditation Program, Maharishi Amrit Kalash, or any other aspect of Maharishi Ayurveda, please contact the Maharishi Ayurveda Association of America. The number is listed in your education packet. Thank you.